Hi everyone, how are you today? Welcome back to my channel, where you can learn and practice coding at the same time. Some of you may know that I did a live stream last Sunday at 9 a.m. as scheduled. And just because it was the first time, I never done a live stream before. There were a few problems here and there. I also realized that not all viewers are currently working as coders. Many of you are new students or someone who wants to change their profession. So I have to change my approach and go a little slower pace. And I hope that you will understand. The topic today is how to call an emergency department record step by step. So let's get right into it. If you want to take note for your study, then please pause the video and get your pencil and notepad ready. If you want to call a new record effectively and completely, you have to know how to extract the information from the record. And in order to do that, you must understand how the ED physician document their records. Below are three keys component you would find on any ED record. First, the history. Second, the physical examination. And third, the medical decision making. Each of these components is evaluated by a set of guidelines. And if you're coding for a physician or professional, then you got to know these components very well before you assign an in-name level for him or her. On the other hand, if you are coding for a facility, in other words, for a hospital, all you need to know is how to extract the crucial information from the three components before you assign any diagnosis and procedure codes. I'm going to break down each component in more detail in the next slide. The first component is the history. The history includes four elements. The first element, chief complaint, CC. The second element, history of present illness, HPI. The third element, reviewer system, ROS. And the fourth element, past medical, family, and social history, PFSH. In the chief complaint and history of present illness, you're going to know why they are here. What brought them to the emergency department? It could be a fever, a headache, an abdominal pain, a chest pain, a cut on a finger, or a broken bone, etc. What I'm going to tell you next is very important and I need your attention. If they come in because of a non-injury disease or condition, for example, a fever, a headache, or a chest pain, then you obtain this information, and this is good enough for extracting information from the chief complaint and the history of present illness. However, if they come in because of an injury-related condition, for example, a cut on a finger, an ankle sprain, a burn on the body, or a broken bone, then you have to find out how that happened and where. It's required by some states that you have to report the external cause code. If you assign an IC10CM diagnosis code for an injury without the external cause code, the account will not be processed and will return to you for recoding. It's not a good feeling when you receive email from your coding manager asking you to recode your account every single day because of this. It makes you look like you don't know what you're doing. And it's simply because you totally forget about this external cause code. Next, for the reviewer system, if you go for a physician or professional, then you have to pay attention to this element. If you call for a facility or hospital, don't spend too much time on it. You keep moving on to the past medical history. This element is very important because it will tell you any comorbidity, in other words, any chronic condition that a patient may have, for example, diabetes, hypertension, coronary heart disease, COPD, tobacco smoking, history of cancer, alcohol abuse, etc. These conditions may complicate the treatment, so we have to monitor it, and it should be reported. A cut on a finger of a non-diabetic patient is much easier to treat compared to a diabetic neuropathy patient with blood vessel complication. I hope you got the idea. The second component is examination. Below is an example of the examination document looks like. I review this section just to obtain the site of the injury, either left or right, or bilateral. If I couldn't find this information from the chief complaint or history of present illness from the previous slide. One of the unique attributes to the ICD-10-CM code set is that laterality has been built into the code description, so you have to code it correctly. Stay away from the unspecified codes as much as you can. The third component is medical decision making. Everything I just showed you up to this point is a general information about why they are here and any chronic condition or comorbidity that they also have when they arrive at the emergency department. But so far, you don't know how we treat them yet. So the medical decision making, MDM, is very, very important. The physician will document how they treat their patient and also document the final diagnosis. After they perform the history and physical exam, or the some workup, for example, lab test, X-ray, EKG, CT scan, ultrasound, etc., or perform some procedure like laceration repair, abscess incision and drainage, nasal packing for nose bleeding, lumbar puncture, or a small bone fracture, claw reduction, etc. Now, your job is to code them correctly and appropriately. Each coder will have his or her own way of how to code on any record, and I don't think the school will teach you this. These are my own steps that I want to share with you based on my own experience, so that you can code on any record effectively and completely. After extracting the information from the history, examination, and medical decision-making session, then the first step is you have to assign the ICD-10 diagnosis code for the primary, secondary diagnosis, and any comorbidity or chronic condition that the patient may have, and we have to monitor or treat it. Second step, you need to check and make sure that any lab work or diagnosis imaging test that the physician order and perform, for example, CT scan, X-ray, ultrasound, etc., we have a diagnosis code to cover the medical necessity for each study. In other words, the reason why the physician ordered that test. The third step is, after I assign the diagnosis code for the record, and it could be one or it could be 10 codes, depending on the presenting problem, I check my codes and sequence it to make sure that I line them up properly according to the official coding guideline. The fourth step is to assign CPT code for any procedure that is performed. For example, a laceration repair, a nasal packing, a small bone fracture reduction, or a lumbar puncture, etc. You may also have to code the IV infusion, and charge the Indian level for the facility. It's different from hospital to hospital. I have to call them all. Now you know your cost and charge will directly affect the reimbursement. In other words, the payment that we are going to receive from the payers. That is why a well-trained emergency coder for both professional and facility are hard to find. That's all for today. Thank you so much for watching. Thanks so much for liking and sharing. And don't forget to subscribe to my channel. You are the reason I am making these videos. I also want to acknowledge those teachers on YouTube like me, spending their own valuable time to share their knowledge and coding skill with all of you. I understand how hard it is to find time after busy working hours, and also time to make the lesson for students. It's not easy. So please kind to one and another. Until next time, have a great day.